Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. I hope you enjoyed this morning and the lunch, and now we're going to go at it again. I want to introduce the moderator of the panel, Mike Noonan, who is the managing director of our program on national security. Although his current research focuses on civil-military relations and defense transformation, he happens to have a unique view of the problem that we're discussing today. When, when some of this aspect of it began to appear, at the Institute, we always like our researchers to get a firsthand acquaintance with the problem. As it turned out, the United States government agreed. And so before we could arrange a grant for Michael to travel to Iraq, they conscripted him as he was a member of the reserves. And so, courtesy of Uncle Sam, he got a direct and intimate experience with the foreign fighter problem, where he served for close to 2 years on a military transition team with an Iraqi light infantry battalion in and around the northern city of Talafer. And that, of course, is very close to the route of the movement of foreign fighters across the Syrian border at that point. So it's my pleasure then to turn this over to Mike, who will be the moderator for this first panel.
Thank you. Good afternoon. First of all, I'd like to thank, give some props to Alan Luxenberg and Jan Luxenberg and Miano, who kind of doing the stuff behind the scenes to kind of make the trains run on time here. So thanks, Alan and Jan and Miano. It's my great pleasure this afternoon to introduce Ian Bryan. Major Bryan is a Air National Guard officer serving on active duty right now at the School of Advanced Air and Space Studies down at Air Force University and Maxwell Air Force Base in Alabama. I met Ian a couple years ago at a conference. Great guy, very smart. I think you're a B-1 pilot, or he's got a law degree, but he's not a JAG officer. He was a line officer. He holds a JD from the University of Virginia Law School and also holds master's degrees in history and political science from the Ohio State University in Columbus, Ohio. Also, we have Mac Owens from the Navy War College. He is the, you can see, he's got a very prolific bio. You can all see in your packets. He's the Associate Dean of Academics for Electives in Directive Research and Professor of National Security Affairs. So we have two of the bases of the professional military education field covered here. He also happens to be a senior fellow at the Institute and the editor of our journal, Orbis. Finally, last not but least, we have Jakub Grygiel from the School of Advanced International Studies at the Johns Hopkins University here in Washington, D.C. He is the George Herbert Walker Bush Associate Professor of International Politics. He's written extensively on geopolitics. He has a great piece in a recent issue of Policy Review that I highly recommend on the power of statelessness, and also has done some extensive writing on geopolitics. So without further ado, Ian.
Thank you, Michael, and thank you, FPRI, for having me. First, disclaimer, I have to point out that anything I say are my own views. They don't represent the Air Force or Department of Defense or United States government, and I didn't wear my uniform today to emphasize that point. Michael called me recently and asked me to serve on the panel and write something about sovereignty and the foreign fighter, and I thought that's terrific. Very interesting, very timely, and I hung up the phone and I thought, what the heck am I going to do with sovereignty and the foreign fighters? A pretty theoretical, abstract concept, sovereignty. But it didn't take me long to come to the conclusion that sovereignty is very important with regard to the foreign fighter problem, not just because, as Michael had pointed out to me, that foreign fighters and their facilitators hide behind sovereignty, but it's important because of legitimacy. Legitimacy is what makes sovereignty and the foreign fighters important. Disregarding sovereignty in order to interdict foreign fighters and their networks before they get to battlefield countries may be operationally compelling, But we need to think carefully about the strategic costs of doing so. Those costs generally come in terms of legitimacy, short-term and long-term. Short-term, the ability to get multilateral cooperation, domestic consensus, things like that. Long-term, what does it do to the international system? What sorts of new norms are we creating? And what is the impact on international law long-term? It's very important to think about what we do with foreign fighters in the larger strategic context. Because if whatever we do is going to have much larger ramifications for the international system and even for great power conflict, which may be on the rise. First of all, I'm going to talk a little bit about foreign fighters. When I discuss foreign fighters, I'm referring as well to their facilitators, their financiers, their recruiters, I am referring to them as well as the foreign fighters themselves, and I'm referring to them before they get to the battlefield country, before they get to the battleground. Foreign fighters, as we've learned today, are as old as war, but they present a lot of new problems and some new opportunities. Certainly since the end of the Cold War, we may have some new opportunities to do things to transgress sovereign borders that may have been more risky during the Cold War. Foreign fighters can create tempting targets as they hide behind sovereign borders. They are often networks concentrated in a small number of cities. They have key nodes, key individuals, and leaders that might make tempting targets. Also, we have increased military precision technology, increased information technology, which may give us some new operational capabilities to use against these nodes and these key individuals. So, question is, why not take full advantage of these new opportunities in order to go after foreign fighters wherever and whenever we find them? When I talk about sovereignty, I'm referring to that key foundational tenet of the international system, that states have the ultimate authority for what goes on within their borders. This idea seems very natural to us, but it's not natural at all. It's a socially constructed idea. It didn't really come about until the 17th century, and the Peace of Westphalia is usually what it's associated with. And like any idea, sovereignty is only powerful as long as it commands respect. The UN Charter and the World War that it followed were watersheds for our modern conception of sovereignty. The UN Charter was designed to avert that major power war that we had just gone through. And so it recognized and codified into international law sovereign borders as nearly absolute and inviolate. Now, sovereignty is important because of legitimacy, like I said. By legitimacy, I mean that wide acceptance of authority, a general view that power is wielded justly. I think if you'll grant me one quote in my talk, E.H. Carr, noted realist, said, quote, "An international order cannot be based on power alone, for the simple reason that mankind will in the long run always revolt against naked power. Any international order presupposes a substantial measure of general consent." So that's what I mean when I talk about legitimacy. And legitimacy is intimately tied with the idea of law. In fact, legitimacy comes from legitimus, which is the Latin for lawful. So what are the costs to the U.S. When transgressing sovereignty to go after foreign fighters? I think they come in two categories. There's first the more short-term, and that is the perceived legitimacy of U.S. action, and the more long-term, which are the corrosion of laws and norms, and you might think of it as the effect on what is considered legitimate over the long haul. legitimacy magnifies American power, in my opinion. And even the United States military comes to increasingly recognize this. Joint operational doctrine today lists legitimacy as one of 12 key principles of operations. I think the new Army Field Manual, Counterinsurgency Field Manual, discusses legitimacy over 100 times in a slightly different context, but it's certainly related. Now, it's not controversial to say that transnational problems require multilateral cooperation. Certainly foreign fighters, terrorists, that is no exception. It's maybe a little less agreed that when the United States takes action that's not considered widely legitimate, that it makes it difficult for governments that would otherwise be friendly towards the United States and would like to cooperate, it makes it more difficult for them to cooperate. I think perception matters, particularly in an era when democracies are among the most powerful countries in the world, and even authoritarian governments find it more difficult to control information. Pakistan is a great example. A lot of U.S. action in Pakistan has been perceived there as not legitimate, transgressing sovereign borders, and it makes it more difficult for the Pakistani government to cooperate in counterterrorism and in stemming the flow of foreign fighters. The United States, though, has an interest not only in being perceived as acting legitimacy in the short term, but also in maintaining a system where legitimacy matters. A strategy that disregards sovereignty undermines, to some extent, the idea of law. And a global power with global interests will find it more costly to operate and find that the international system yields fewer benefits in a system where legitimacy doesn't matter as much. International legitimacy also matters at home to maintain domestic consensus, and we need to maintain consensus to be successful in our long-term strategies against these intractable problems, foreign fighters and terrorism. Certainly, our history from Vietnam to Iraq would demonstrate that it's difficult to maintain a united home front over the long haul without that perceived legitimacy. So, all this does not add up to mean that foreign fighters can hide with impunity behind sovereign borders. There are mechanisms for crossing borders and going after foreign fighters, and the U.S. might need to do some work in order to change international norms and change international law over the long haul in order to adequately address these problems and emerging threats. If you want to think about foreign fighters and sovereignty and legitimacy, you've got to dig into the UN Charter a little bit, because that is the clearest, that is where you're going to find what international law has to say about the problem. So I'm just going to briefly mention three articles in the UN Charter. Article 2A essentially says you can't cross borders, you can't use force. Article 51 is big exception number one. Article 51 says you can use force in self-defense. Article 42 says that members of the Security Council, where they deem that there is a threat to the peace, can use force to take care of that threat and do what is necessary to preserve the peace. Most international experts would say that Article 42 would be the place to justify the sort of action where you would go after foreign fighters or terrorists. The problem is, any permanent member of the Security Council can veto anything under Article 42. So Article 42 these days is pretty much a dead letter in going after foreign fighters and terrorists. So that takes us back to self-defense. There is an argument that Article 51, it refers to the inherent right of self-defense, and therefore it doesn't create a right or modify a right. It only recognizes a right that states have always had, and that would include going after organizations and individuals that you are at war with. regardless of whether they hide behind someone else's sovereignty. However, the UN, the International Court of Justice, and several UN panels have rejected this reasoning, and I think it's safe to say that a consensus among international lawyers is that is not the state of the law today. But interpretation changes, and these decisions in these panels have narrowly drawn their interpretations. And international law is really what the conventional wisdom among states says international law is. And so international law evolves, interpretations of the Charter evolve. We have some cases recently, quite a few cases, where countries have crossed borders and met with a relatively, with a tepid and inconsistent response. And accepted state practice matters a lot in the evolution of international law. We have Israeli action in Gaza and Lebanon. We have Turkish action in northern Iraq. We have U.S. action in Pakistan. And we have the alleged U.S. Strike into Syria to go after the Abu Ghadiyya foreign fighter network. So we may be meandering into a new set of norms and international law. So we need to think carefully about where we're going, because we're going somewhere. If strikes across borders to go after foreign fighters and terrorists are going to be rare, then maybe strained rationales or even silence will be adequate, and they won't do significant harm to the international system as it benefits us today. But if this is some systemic change, if there is something about globalization, about the super empowered individual or what have you, that is going to make crossing borders more important in the future in order to deal with these problems, then we need some new legal rationales, some new measures of legitimacy. And we need to make our rationales clear, which we really haven't made very clear with regard to Pakistan, for example, or Syria. Now, some other areas, weapons of mass destruction and terrorism, may well drive this area of the law. They seem to get the lion's share of print and discussion, but certainly the foreign fighter issue is closely bound up. So how might the law change? A lot of people, a lot of organizations over the last 10, 20 years have been pushing the idea that states have a responsibility to their citizens, and pushing for the legalization, if you will, of humanitarian intervention, and the law has begun to bend in that direction. It's not another big step to say that if governments have a responsibility to their citizens, the governments also have a responsibility to those other states around them that are suffering at the hands of the foreign fighters that use those third countries as bases. But humanitarian intervention still today is recognized by most lawyers as requiring that Article 42 Security Council approval. That only takes you so far. Some would say that we need to establish a new standard. If foreign fighters are hiding somewhere, terrorists are hiding somewhere, certainly what they do is not legal, and you should be able to go after them. The problem is that it's such a malleable rationale that anyone could employ it to any purpose. Some people have suggested that like-minded governments band together and take care of some of these problems. An example might be NATO and Kosovo, the intervention there for humanitarian reasons. Although counter to the Charter, and most analysts would say technically illegal, it still enjoyed a considerable degree of legitimacy because it was undertaken by a broad multilateral coalition with a transparent bureaucratic structure and done for a just cause. The problem with that is, do you then create legitimate space for coalitions that you would rather not have going out and undertaking these sorts of endeavors of their choosing. So we need to think hard before bending norms, law, and legitimacy in any direction, because we're going to be stuck with the results for some time. Now, as an airman, I want to zoom in here to a more operational level for just a second and suggest that all methods of transgressing sovereignty are not necessarily created equal. In Pakistan, there was a ground assault into Pakistan, and the Pakistani government and people were apoplectic. They have certainly not been happy about the drone strikes in Pakistan, but the reaction has not been on the same plane as the land incursion. So where land power necessarily consumes the sovereignty for the space that it operates within, air power doesn't necessarily do that. And air power does not have to target the a nation's or a government's mechanisms of sovereignty in order to carry out its mission. That's not to suggest that land power may not bring other benefits that are worth the price in sovereignty sometimes, but it does suggest that all means are not the same. I'm going to wrap this up. Pakistan really brings to life a lot of these issues regarding sovereignty, legitimacy, and the foreign fighter. We've seen there where our action has in some ways undermined the government and made it more difficult for the government itself to deal with the problem. But at the same time, it's almost undeniable that it's enjoyed some operational success and taken out many key enemy leaders. Transgressing sovereignty has a lot of costs that are not always apparent in the first analysis, and that's what I've tried to lay out here today. And as you think through this and you think through our strategy, sometimes it might then make more sense to pay the extra cost to get those third countries to deal effectively with foreign fighters. It certainly may seem to raise the relative benefit if you include all the costs of transgressing sovereignty. But sovereignty itself may have to change. We need a strategy. We need to think about what we want sovereignty to look like in the future. We need to think through some of these dilemmas that I've raised. Otherwise, we're just going to be headed for a more dangerous and unsettled world. And the United States is going to need a lot of legitimacy in order to bend these norms and laws in any given direction. Thank you.
Mac?
It's great to be here. I love to do FPR stuff. This is a very important topic, and I have to tell you that my knowledge of this has been expanded today. I'm from Texas, and actually I'm a descendant of James Bowie, not directly, of course, but of his brother. He was one of the early insurgents. He was one of the freedom fighters that came later. He married into the Mexican families, by the way. So, anyway, it's interesting stuff, and it's interesting how sometimes we look at a particular problem and look at it somehow as if it's never happened before. But this is just indicative of how broad this issue is. We owe a debt of gratitude to Major Bryan for his discussion of the need to balance the requirement to respond to threats from foreign fighters who seek sanctuary or transit through states, either those states that wish to aid them or fail states, and on the other hand, the maintenance of the very cornerstone of the international order, which is sovereignty. Now, the fact is we face a new geopolitical reality, and I think that's sort of the answer. I want to expand on basically his theme here of trying to adapt to the present circumstances. Now, as my colleague here, Jakub Grygiel, said several years ago in a book called Great Powers and Geopolitical Change, the fact is when geopolitical reality changes, strategy has to change. And if it doesn't, the country we're talking about is going to face some problems. And I suggest in many respects we're in the same situation as described by the Italian communist Antonio Gramsci in the 1920s, where he said, the old order has died, the new has not yet arisen, and in the interregnum, the morbid symptoms appear. I think that's the situation you have here. With the end of the Cold War, you got the collapse, of course, of the Soviet Empire, continued collapse of some of the empires actually that declined in after World War I. And the question is, how do we adapt to that situation? We're talking about geopolitics, and geopolitics, when you really describe it, is the nexus of geography, capital, and technology. Sometimes geopolitics is dismissed as simply geographic determinism, but in fact, geopolitics can change as a result of the importation of capital or technological change or the like. And I think that's, in many respects, what we face today. Our geopolitical situation, probably from World War I to the end of the Cold War, was sort of as that described by people like Mackinder and Spikeman, with the focus primarily on heartlands and rimlands and so forth, with the shatter belts and so forth pushed off to the side. And it may be the case today that the shatter belts are more important and that we need to look at them probably a little bit differently. And as a way of addressing this, I think we got a roadmap, despite the flaws in the book and the arguments and so forth, from one of my former colleagues at the Naval War College named Thomas Barnett, who wrote something called The Pentagon's New Map. You may be familiar with the argument there. His argument says that the new geopolitical reality is that the most important fault line is not between the rich and the poor, but between those who accept modernity and those who reject it. The former part of the globe, Barnett called the functioning core, the latter the non-integrating gap. According to Barnett, the core is composed of North America, Europe, Japan, Russia, India, China, Brazil, Chile, and Argentina. The gap includes South America, minus Brazil, Argentina, and Chile, most of Africa, the Middle East, and Central Asia. This part of the world contains most of the failed states that epitomize the perceived failures of globalization. Before 9/11, U.S. policymakers acted in accordance with a rule set that focused on interstate conflict within the core and consigned security concerns within the gap to the status of lesser included cases. So you got the focus on China with both Clinton and Bush, and a failure to recognize that you had basically the underbelly of globalization emerging in the form of Al Qaeda and others. The problem with this rule set is it left much of the gap, that is, the disconnected regions of the world, in a Hobbesian state of nature. You recall wherein the life of man is solitary, poor, nasty, brutish, and short, always reminds me of a law firm, led by educated elites such as Obama bin Laden, who desired to keep their regions disconnected from the grasp of globalization and American empire. The gap struck directly at the core with 9/11. For Barnett, the key to future global security and prosperity is the requirement of the core to shrink the gap. Managing the gap, a policy of containment, is not enough. Such an approach further reduces what little connectivity the gap has with the core and renders it more dangerous to the core over the long haul. The core must export security into the gap, providing the stability necessary for the regions within to achieve connectivity with the rest of the world and thereby position themselves to benefit from globalization. Otherwise, the gap will continue to export terrorism to the core it has been doing for the last decade. So basically what Barnett was arguing here is that if you get 9/11 as sort of the violent feedback to the core as a result of globalization, the attempt to create systems perturbations within the core so that he would be able to take the Islamic world offline from globalization and return it to some 7th century definition of good life. For Barnett, the proper strategic response to 9/11 is to create a countervailing system perturbation in the gap, which is exactly what the Bush administration did by striking Afghanistan and Iraq. The point here is that Barnett's gap is critical to understanding the new geopolitics of terrorism. The gap is sanctuary writ large. It provides the ungoverned space, the guerrillas and armed groups can exploit to provide the unassailable base that T.E. Lawrence believed to be so important to the success of irregular fighters. As Lawrence observed, such a base may not only be physical, but also psychological, existing in the minds of men who accept the creed of the guerrilla or who are intimidated into acquiescence. Whether it's located in South Waziristan, the Pakansi Gorge, the Baka Valley, Fallujah, or the Banyeles of Paris, terrorism needs some physical, geographical, or psychological locus in order to exert material force. So if you accept this argument, and of course not everybody does, what we're looking at is the recognition that while sovereignty is important, it provides legitimacy to the international order, we have to be able to adapt to this situation. And perhaps the strategy or the policy that Major Bryan is looking for is that it should be our policy to respect the sovereignty only of those states that can govern legitimately and effectively. And that therefore we're dealing with situations such as ungoverned spaces where it is sometimes necessary to intervene to violate what would otherwise be seen as the source of problems hiding behind this issue of sovereignty. Now, we actually have an example from our own history, which is the example of Andrew Jackson in 1819. And you may know the story, but basically what happened was that Florida at this time was part of Spain, part of the Spanish Empire. And basically, renegade Indians, Creeks, Seminoles, so forth, were raiding into Georgia from Florida. Without much authority, Andrew Jackson, crossed into Florida, burned a couple of Indian villages, attacked a Spanish fort, and hanged a couple of British citizens who had been inciting the rebellion here. And of course, this is something of an international incident, as you can imagine. And everybody on President Monroe's cabinet wanted his head, especially John Calhoun, the Secretary of War. The only guy who really supported Jackson in this, interestingly enough, was his future enemy, John Quincy Adams. And Adams argued, no, this can be used as the basis for getting Spain to basically give up Florida. And the argument being that if Spain could not protect the sovereignty of the state, could not prevent these sorts of things, then it had two choices, either for these things to continue or to sell Florida to the United States. And in effect, of course, that's exactly what happened. Now, is that a perfect analogy talking about foreign fighters? Well, of course not. And the broader issue here, and I think which lies at the heart of the dilemma that Major Bryan was talking about, is this requirement that when you make these sorts of decisions, what you're really invoking here is sort of Aristotelian prudence. Aristotle himself called prudence the highest virtue of the statesman. And what we're talking about here is the ability to adapt the universal principle, that is your goal, to the particular circumstances. And I would always argue that strategy is a species of prudence, because you have to make these adaptations all the time. And so I would only add that as refinements to your otherwise fine paper. Thank you.
Hecker. Well, thank you. Let me also commend Major Bryan on his paper. I think it's a well-written, clear, and stimulating paper, and I highly recommend it that you read it. Above all, I think his argument is very measured. It's almost cautious, and I just realized that he's a lawyer by training, so that explains it, but presents a very cogent defense of sovereignty. There may be clear operational urgency to break the sovereignty of another state in order to eradicate or perhaps mitigate the flow of foreign fighters. But as he presents it, there are also serious long-term costs of breaking that sovereignty because, as he argues, breaking sovereignty may, in the long run, diminish U.S. legitimacy as well as, perhaps more abstractly and broadly, undermine the very concept of sovereignty to which we really don't have a clear, for which we have no clear replacement. And that's an ordering principle for international relations. So having said that, that's, as I understand it, his core argument. Let me structure my comments around three sets of points. And they're responses to the papers, perhaps critiques, but by and large ideas that kind of arose in my mind from reading this paper. The first set of points has to do with definitions. And we talked about the definition of foreign fighters before, so I won't rehash that at length. But it seems to me that there's still differences between, you know, a Yemeni individual in Iraq and a Uyghur in Afghanistan, or for that matter, a Marine County fanatic in Mazar el-Sharif. And the difference for the purposes of this paper have to do with the question of who is responsible for them, or who do we think is responsible for these foreign fighters. And this leads me to my second point in this set of points here about definitions. The definition of state and sovereignty. I think there are at least three very quick, simplistic categories that we can have. The first category of states are those that are supportive of foreign fighters. Think of Iran and some of its forces in Iraq. The second category will be states that are opposed to foreign fighters, that don't like them. They're perhaps chasing them out of their territory, and perhaps they're more than willing to kill them if they get them. Think of the Uyghurs and China. Third category will be failed, weak states that have little or no control over their own territory and therefore over their own citizens. Think of Pakistan and Somalia. And you can nuance these categories in multiple ways, but I think just making that distinction changes also our understanding of sovereignty and what we do about sovereignty, and also changes and alters our calculation of the costs and benefits of breaking sovereignty, because they will be different in the different cases. This leads me to my second and set of points. The paper presents clear costs of violating sovereignty, and therefore we need to be very careful about weakening the norm, the concept of sovereignty, because there's really, again, no alternative way of ordering international relations. Having said that, though, I think there are also clear costs of not breaking sovereignty, a clear cost of an overly respectful attitude towards sovereignty. And let me mention sort of three points here. The first, I think if you elevate respect for sovereignty above all, then those states who are capable will have little incentive to crack down on the flow of foreign fighters if they deem them to be in their national interest. Sovereignty, in other ways, matters because you can threaten to break it. And that threat is a tool in our hands to force that state, that target state, to do things that otherwise perhaps they were not willing to do. So again, using sovereignty and the threat of violating that sovereignty to achieve our goals. Second point about the costs of respecting too much state sovereignty has to do with the link between legitimacy and respect for state sovereignty, which is in many ways a core argument of the paper. That is that our actions will be perceived as legitimate both domestically and internationally when we try to respect the sovereignty of other states. And I think the argument is correct, but I think it's worth also at least consider the other way of arguing. That is that respecting sovereignty too much and too often may lead to a loss of our legitimacy, both domestically and internationally. Domestically, I think we care about security, perhaps democracy promotion, commercial interests, depending on whom you ask, but not sovereignty per se. The legitimacy of our foreign policy derives from how we pursue our national interests, not from how much we respect the sovereignty of other states, whether on a conceptual level or in practice. Similarly, I think internationally, the opposition that we received recently in the past several years to our interventions doesn't really stem from some sort of adoration for sovereignty. It would be a stretch to say that Russia loves state sovereignty. They definitely proved otherwise last year in Georgia. So the opposition, and therefore, as we see, the lack of legitimacy of our actions, stems from something else. Maybe dislike for what we do, maybe dislike for our own policy, or maybe just a desire to create problems for us. Similarly, again, from an international perspective, a lot of international support for our actions stems or derives from our ability and willingness to intervene in other countries in defiance of democracy, human rights,
and in general of something that we deem higher and more valuable than a line in a map. And again, I think sovereignty is not the reason why people support us, or our defense of sovereignty is not the reason why people always support us. So that's the second set of arguments of why respecting sovereignty too much may be actually a cost. Finally, a third argument in favor of not respecting sovereignty, if I want to make that argument, is that what we're talking about here, it seems to be two parallel strategic reality. On the one hand, you have states that function along principles of sovereignty. On the other hand, you have this parallel reality of the foreign fighters who function on some other line, which is not sovereignty. Whether it's ethnic reasons, whether it's religious motivations, whatever it is not state sovereignty. They do not function according to that principle. So you have essentially sort of like a soccer team and a football team meeting on in a stadium and playing completely two different games. And we can't force foreign fighters to respect sovereignty. But sticking on a almost ideological basis to sovereignty limits our ability to play the game and to respond to the threat that foreign fighters, the denials of sovereignty, play. So in many ways, accepting the principle of sovereignty without any caveats is a cost and will limit our ability to respond, defend ourselves, and even to understand the problem. As a sort of smaller footnote here, sovereignty as a concept is fairly clear, but in practice, it's not that clear. Sovereignty, probably for half of the planet, doesn't really exist. There are probably, I don't have the numbers, probably somebody out there is better well-versed on this than I am, but probably there are more weak and failed states on the planet than what we consider strong states. So the question is often not to break sovereignty, but how do you deal in situations where sovereignty doesn't exist? What do you do in those cases where sovereignty is just literally a line in a map, but nothing in reality? And again, the question then becomes not breaking sovereignty, but what to do when sovereignty doesn't exist. Second quick footnote. It seems to me, and I'm not saying that the paper does it, but there's no foreign policy that doesn't break sovereignty. Every type of foreign policy, especially of a great power, is a form of intervention in the sovereignty of the other state. After all, the foreign policy, especially of a great power, is a policy that tries to force the other state to do things that that state doesn't want to do, by and large. You're trying to force other states to function and behave in ways that they, as sovereign entities, would not do. So that in and of itself is some sort of violation of sovereignty. Let me quickly then move to policy recommendations. And it's always dangerous to comment on policy recommendations of a lawyer because I have no idea on how to improve law or the UN Charter or the functioning of the UN General Assembly. But let me make two points here. The first one has to do with the methods of violating sovereignty. And Major Bryan mentioned about the beauty of Air Force and how that's much more gentle way of breaking sovereignty. I'll take him at face value, but I think the larger point that can be made is that there's a difference between territorial occupation and intervention. And I think there may be a trend, and it's always hard to talk about present trends, but there may be a trend away from occupation, as in territorial control of the target state and replacement of its function by the invading force, a trend away from that because of military costs, because of technological diffusion developments, as well as sort of the greater political participation of an awareness of people, and away up from occupation and towards intervention, which is, I would define as sort of temporary, very short-term, targeted penetration of the sovereignty of other states for a very narrowly defined objective. And whether that's achieved through Air Force or through some other covered actions or however you want to define it, I think that's one way of dealing with this problem and solving this dilemma of breaking the sovereignty and making sure that the long-term costs are not too high. A second set of policy recommendations is, and has been mentioned before, one way of, you know, shorthand for this is building walls. But if you look at the problem of foreign fighters, the challenge is their mobility. The fact that they can move from state A into a target state and they can travel. And traditionally, historically, foreign fighters, whether they're, you know, we were talking during lunch about the Crusades, but if they didn't have a means of transportation, they were not foreign fighters. They couldn't get to the place where they're going. So a way of mitigating the problem is to control and limit mobility of foreign fighters. How do you do it? Secure borders, one, but making, broadly speaking, travel more difficult. And this goes against our notion of how beautiful globalization is. It's so nice to, you know, go to Dallas Airport and fly in 12 hours to Tel Aviv or wherever you want to, but that there are certain costs associated with that. The ease of travel makes foreign fighters more likely and more mobile. There was an interesting study of Jamia Islamia, and I can't remember the author, but and the study was on how when the state made travel within their territory more difficult, it didn't eradicate the problem of terrorists, but it pushed the organization towards areas that are much more difficult to access. So instead of traveling on the road, there are checkpoints, difficult to travel by train, plane, they had to go through a jungle. They didn't get rid of the problem, but it made the organization much more, functioning of the organization much more difficult and their actions less effective. So again, you know, there are ways of responding to this challenge, which doesn't have to deal with rewriting formulating the norm of sovereignty or even the legal interpretation of it. It's a way of working within the framework that we have, and as Mac Owens said, using, I guess, prudential judgment to figure out how much and when it's worthwhile to limit sovereignty or break the sovereignty of a different state. Let me end at that, and we can open the discussion.
Thanks. And care to respond?
Sure. I agree with pretty much everything I've heard. I thought it was interesting Colonel Owens brought up Barnett's book and the need for the core countries to take action to shrink the gap, to shrink that failing, the failing areas, the failing states, because that's where so much of our trouble comes from. The problem, of course, is getting those core states to do it in a way that is today considered legitimate, which pretty much requires the Security Council to agree or to keep to prevent Russia or China or France from vetoing what you're trying to do. Jakub's comments, I agree almost completely with what you said. You talked about the costs of not breaking sovereignty. Very true. And you can threaten to break it, and that provides you with a lever. You know, I wonder in Pakistan if our actions transgressing sovereignty there didn't pressure their government to actually do more about the problem. I don't know if that's the case, but it may well be. You talked about how we deal with areas where sovereignty doesn't really exist. And of course, the question as far as legitimacy is who decides? Who decides when and who decides where? That doesn't mean you can't do it. It's just if you do and the when and the where are not widely perceived as legitimate, or you begin to use that excuse for other things, then you pay an increasing price. So I agree with your critiques. I think they're good critiques, and you probably offer more solution than I do.
Okay. Great. Before we open it up to some questions, I'm just going to throw something out to the panel. Mac kind of pointed out the Florida example. Anna Simons and some Army Special Forces officers who are students at the Naval Postgraduate School wrote an article in a forthcoming book called The Sovereignty Solution. And kind of one of their key, we've been talking about, you know, respecting or breaking sovereignty. How about the other solution of holding nations more accountable for their sovereignty and putting higher prices on them in terms of trade, in terms of other things, to make them responsible for their, you know, whether it's real or, you know, kind of illusory about their own territorial sovereignty, hold them accountable, and then perhaps use punitive expeditions or other things as kind of incentive levers there. I'm just going to throw that out for the panel before we open up.
Well, I mean, I think in many respects that's what we did in 1819. The punitive raid, well, I think it was a message to the Spanish that the choice they had was either to maintain, enforce the sovereignty of this, what Adams called derelict province, or sell it to the United States. I mean, that somebody who could actually provide the enforcement of sovereignty, although our Second Seminole War maybe indicates that it's a little more difficult than we'd originally thought. But I think that's very much what we did in 1819.
But that's also kind of more of a, you know, you break it, you bought it kind of proposition where we're going to, you know, take it over. Anybody else?
Well, you know, foreign fighters and terrorists, one of their greatest assets is it's difficult to coerce them. They generally don't have an address. And states, you do have more levers to use against. And where you can make a clear connection between a state and foreign fighter activity, that is certainly an option. And I don't mean to suggest that it's one that should be off the table, but it's just my comments are primarily to try and point out some of the costs. But some of the options that you mentioned, you know, economic measures, things like that, maybe less effective, maybe require broader participation to have any significant effect, but don't run into the sorts of legitimacy problems that some of these other measures. There are a lot of different areas to think about. In my paper, I had a brief mention of cyberspace. We're not really even sure how cyberspace relates to sovereignty or if it does, or what's being done with regard to foreign fighters via cyberspace, cyber attack, reaching into other countries. But there are other instruments than the military instrument, obviously, and some of those come with fewer side effects, but also maybe less guarantee of direct effectiveness.
Couple of points on holding states accountable. I think that's one way to do it is exactly what I mentioned, sort of the threat of breaking sovereignty, right? So that we have to have in as one of the tools at our disposal. And so we, therefore, my point again, we can't just, and I'm not saying again that Major Bryan did that, but we can't just elevate sovereignty to something that is, you can't break at all costs. It's something that we always have to respect. So holding nations accountable requires the threat of breaking sovereignty. The question then is, though, when that sovereignty doesn't exist, and I can speak for Anna Simons and the book, which I think is actually a very interesting book, having read the manuscript, but what do you do when there's no state? Well, then you have to sort of lower the level of accountability, because there's always some sort of ordering organization, right? There's no such a thing as chaos, right? There may be no state, there may be no state authority, but there'll be tribal authority. There'll be clans. Well, so you have to lower that accountability and adjust the level of accountability to depending on situation. A second quick sort of general point is that I think the questions that we're having here actually point out to the difficulty of figuring out the problem. Because even the responses that we're coming up with bring back sovereignty. As if we didn't have any other way, which may be true, we don't have any other way of managing, of responding to the problem. I bet you that You know, if this was a panel run by foreign fighters, however defined, they would not be talking about sovereignty as a strategy or how to deal with sovereignty. They'll be talking about something completely different. So I'm not sure how, again, I guess my analogy of two teams playing completely different rules. How do we talk to each other? Well, probably can't, but how do we manage each other? How do we mitigate the threat of the other side when we don't even have, I think, the vocabulary in many ways to understand and present the problem?
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we've reached Q&A time. If you have a question, just line up at either one of the microphones. If you have a question, ask it. We are playing by Jeopardy rules, though. If you have a speech, please form it or make it in the form of a question. The floor is open.
Hi. Many borders are in dispute. Many autonomous regions are in dispute. Does it make it easier or more difficult for a third party to violate sovereignty in a disputed area? We have border disputes in the Pakistan tribal areas, et cetera. And are there any examples that you can think of?
Well, I mean, you know, just a general observation that part of the problem with establishing sovereignty is where you draw these lines. And many of these lines, as we all know, are arbitrary based on colonial maps and the like, especially in Africa and in the Middle East. Lines in the sand or, you know, lines in the jungle, basically, which is part of the problem. You know, I point out there's an inherent contradiction or tension between two principles in international law. On the one hand, you have states. We all know what a state is. It's a territorial organization. And the key to statehood and therefore international order, presumably, is sovereignty, which we've talked about. There are also, broader, less definable ideas such as nations, groups that are bound by some principle. And the problem there, of course, is that the principle that governs them is something called self-determination. And those two principles, sovereignty and self-determination, are in tension, especially exacerbated by the lines in the sand. So you take a group that has a concept of nation like the Kurds. Well, the problem with the Kurdish state right now is it would violate the sovereignty of at least three other states, most of whom are not willing to give up their sovereignty over that particular area. But I think that the problem with international relations is that we sometimes seek the best solution where the best is the enemy of the good. And you've just mentioned a problem that really makes international relations so much more difficult is, you know, where are these lines drawn and why?
I wonder if disputed regions might be more difficult sometimes for foreign fighters just because the borders are often more heavily patrolled. The government is more interested in what's going on there. That's my only input.
I'm wondering if you see that there's a necessary tension in this sovereignty debate, that nations don't always want there to be as much sovereignty. They want a little ambiguity in what sovereignty is and what, take for instance in Iraq, you mentioned maybe a national ID card sort of thing, allowing checkpoints and stuff like that. You know, and when I first went to Iraq, we worked on national ID cards. But the Iraqi government doesn't want national ID cards. They don't want to know how many Kurds there are, because right now the Kurds can claim there are 17% Kurds. Maybe there are, maybe there aren't. If there aren't, then, you know, that affects our national budget and it affects the whole political situation, really knowing. That this ambiguity actually allows states to exercise in the international arena where they wouldn't be able to if there was a clearer image of what sovereignty was and how it was imposed.
I think locally, certainly I think what you're raising varies a lot from place to place. But even in Iraq, Iraqis are very interested in their sovereignty.
by and large. Would you agree with that?
No, I'm saying that, but what sovereignty is and how it's imposed, I think states want some ambiguity there.
Right, but if they have one clear idea about sovereignty, it's that foreigners don't get a say in what goes on inside their borders. We'll have to agree to disagree on that.
Well, I think what your question is and your observation is that there may be different ways through which sovereignty is manifested. So there, it's smaller of a practical level. What's more feasible? What's more politically palatable in a specific country? National ID. Well, I presume that in the U.S. we don't want a national and federal ID, right? We like state driver's licenses, right? We don't want DC to run everything. So, I mean, there are different ways in which that... What?
Too late.
Too late, yeah, exactly. There are different ways in which sovereignty domestically can be manifested. I think there are more cases, obviously, when a state wants to weaken the sovereignty of somebody else and wants to do it through a variety of means which are under the military horizon. And, you know, there are tons of consequences for that. I mean, the example that I have in mind, which kind of goes away from the topic here, but the creation of dual structures by Russia, so essentially giving passports to people in South Ossetia or Ukraine and saying, well, you know, they're ours, or Estonia, right? That weakens the sovereignty of those states. So that's, you know, that's one way to do it. The second comment I want to make on this is that there may be such a thing as ambiguous sovereignty and weakness of a state that can be turned into a strength. And I have no proof for this, so it's pure speculation. But if you think of Pakistan, you know, they could be saying to us, don't push us too hard, we're weak. If you press us around about, you know, the Northwest Territories and tell us what to do, we may fall. What are you gonna get? You may get a worse situation, right? So it's almost like deterrence by threat of failure of yourself, which is, you know, strange, perhaps not terribly logical, but it may work. So you may have an interest in not strengthening your sovereignty domestically, because then you can use that to say to other states, don't press me, right? Stay away from me.
Yeah. Alan, do we have any questions from online?
No. Disrespecting the sovereignty of other countries, while it might be to some extent reasonable if it is executed by a responsible power, wouldn't on the long run, though, this might cause a situation of chaos in the world by some other countries, developing countries or countries of limited interest to attack, that they find their own reasons to legitimize certain aggressive action against other countries surrounding them or away from them? I mean, wouldn't that contribute negatively on the long run in the peaceful situation of, you know, the world?
Well, I think that's Major Bryan's argument, is basically that the danger with violating sovereignty, no matter how good the purpose is it undermines the principle. And we have to be very prudent when we do these sorts of things. That's not to say, I think as Jakub basically said, it's not to say that sovereignty is the highest goal. Remember, sovereignty is not an end, sovereignty is a means. It's a means to security and liberty within the state. A state has to be able to protect its own sovereignty. And you know, that's what's at issue. You're not really sovereign unless you can protect your sovereignty. That sounds circular, but I think it's a truism that's true, that you know, suggests that you have to be able to do this. But I mean, the principle, the problem, as we say in international relations, is that it's all not all clear cut. It's ambiguous, just like borders in many cases. And so that's where the issue of prudence has to come in. Under what circumstances do you bear the cost of violating sovereignty, keeping in mind exactly what you said, that the danger is that it provides an example to others to say, well, if they do that, then why can't we?
So the strikes in Pakistan have been going on for a while now, but with the recent alleged U.S. strike on Abu Ghadir in Syria and the recent alleged Israeli strikes in Sudan on the foreign fighter pipeline there into Gaza, have you seen any changes in the international legal community in the way these topics are being discussed since it's kind of expanding away from Pakistan and into other areas?
Honestly, I haven't really, and I think that this merges a lot with counterterrorism and really what's pushing this area of the law. And at this point, it's really more people intellectualizing about and trying to think through the problem. But it's the potential for terrorists to gain WMD. And what are we going to do about that? And how are we going to come up with a way to prevent sovereign borders from standing in our way of dealing with that problem? And so the foreign fighter problem, I think, is sort of trailing behind that right now, which is predominantly a body of scholarship and maybe also unstated policy or in some cases stated policy. But we haven't seen really any overt evolution in international law at this point, is my judgment.
Please. Question to you, because I don't know much about this, but the absence of a discussion in the legal community about this, is it due to the fact that this is, you know, the examples that you gave are sort of like the don't ask, don't tell policy? You know, don't ask me what I did, I won't tell you that I bombed Sudan or Syria. And in the moment you have that, you can't really discuss it because, mm-hmm. it doesn't exist on paper. Mm-hmm. Would that be a solution? Sort of don't ask, don't tell, bomb when you have to, but don't talk about it?
I think that could be a solution if it were going to be rare. But I wonder how much more prevalent this is going to become and how much more necessary. And is it going to become a WMD and terrorism issue? And the presentation we got this morning suggested that foreign fighters as a phenomenon are on the rise. And if it's something that we are going to need to deal with in a more systematic way, I think it's something that we should get some better legitimacy levers to help us with this problem, because otherwise I think it's going to exact a heavy cost on us in terms of trying to maintain an international order that serves our interests.
Mike.
Thanks. I was wondering about the relationship between sovereignty and state capacity, since some people, you know, you could make the argument that really talking about sovereignty sort of misses the point, because the sort of questions of sovereignty only exist where most of the cases that we're talking about are states that lose control the further you get away from their capital cities, essentially. And although a potential counterexample to that might be the United States, which we consider to have a lot of state capacity, yet obviously has some issues with border control. So I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about what you think the relationship is between sovereignty and sort of state capacity, and since it seems like these issues, it might be useful to talk about them together, especially with regards to foreign fighters.
Well, this may be an area where legitimacy and law are really diverging. International law under the United Nations system was designed to prevent major state war, designed in the wake of World War II, and not designed for a world where foreign fighters and terrorists are a major threat. And so, as a matter of technical international law, I'd say the fact that sovereignty is very weak, or some countries do not control areas of their country, is not so important as far as international law is concerned, certainly not under the United Nations Charter. But I think that there is a growing awareness, I think 9/11 was probably the precipitating event for the entire world, that this law, these norms, may need to catch up with the security environment that we face today and in the future. And so I think when you do take action against these foreign fighters or terrorists, you may do so in a way that garners some legitimacy. Just as I mentioned, the NATO operation in Kosovo, though technically probably violation of international law, garnered a fair amount of international legitimacy. And so I think that's where we stand with that. The question, of course, again, comes back to who decides, and are we creating legitimate space for others to become more adventurous that we don't want to? What are those long-term costs? And here I think maybe re-emerging great power rivalry may have some things to say to us about what we want to do as we work to sort of reshape the international environment, or what we may not want to do. And I know that's something that Jakub has written on, but.
You know, it seems like there's two fundamental aspects of sovereignty. The first is legitimacy. Do you get a legitimate right to rule, to govern? And the other is effectiveness. And the latter is what you're really kind of talking about. And effectiveness, there's two sides of effectiveness. There's the ability, of course, to defend your borders, but also the ability to control what goes on within your borders so that, you know, you're not having marauders, you know, cross over into other other states to create mayhem and so forth. So I think that those two provide the cornerstone. I agree. I think part of the problem is sometimes the law takes a while to catch up to the to the realities on the ground, just like sometimes strategy takes a while to catch up to the geopolitical realities of the situation. So,
if I just may add to that, I mean, I agree with everything that's been said. Historically, I think there have been ways of dealing with absence of state capacity, right? And so traditionally, I think it was done by great powers. They simply would take over, partition a state that was not functioning, right? Later on, it was the UN mandate system. We don't like it because it has sort of these colonial connotations. But essentially, you know, in the 90s, if you were reading literature on state failure, they were talking about some version thereof of a UN mandate system. They were calling it different ways, but essentially some sort of international, run mostly by the UN, system of governance for these states. Former Yugoslavia, I mean, that's what you have essentially, right? You have the dispute about the sovereignty of some of these states, very limited state capacities of these newly formed states, some sort of international force, UN, later on EU, and so on and so forth, that takes over. There doesn't seem to be, and again, I'm not a lawyer, there doesn't seem to be a legal structure. It's almost an ad hoc, as I understand it, right? Here's a case, we agree, let's do it. But it's not like a principle of international governance that takes over zones of no state capacities. It's depends on an interest, on agreement. And in many ways, I think so far we've been lucky that happened to Yugoslavia, however tragic, because it's close to Europe. It's where the Germans go to vacation in August. You know, they like it. If this happens in the middle of nowhere, say Sudan, there doesn't seem to be interest in having some sort of international EU, NATO, UN, however you want to phrase it, system of governance.
Thanks. Alan?
Do we believe all three of these potential areas or states would have issues in common that we could capitalize on from a policy perspective?
You know, in some respects, you can say that the problem here is akin to ballistic missile defense. Everybody knows, I think, that the most effective way to shoot down a missile is to get it in the boost phase while it's, you know, still moving slowly. If you have to wait till the mid-course phase or the terminal phase when it deploys all of its warheads and so forth, it's much more difficult. So it seemed to me that, you know, maybe that's part of the policy here is developing, hard to do, but developing different sorts of approaches where, you know, again, especially if you're talking about countries that are our friends or allies, where we could basically, it's like Saudi Arabia, for instance. Okay, I think we had some success with them. But other states where we can do some of the things that we talked about earlier in terms of applying a little bit of economic pressure to be able to do that with the origin, states of origin, also some variation of that with the you know, the states of transit and so forth. But there would seem to be some argument for basically breaking up our policy to respond to particular types of states. I don't know if you'd come up with a general policy, but it might be worth a try.
Yeah, I've been listening to the discussion, and I was trying to look at, this has been an issue for terrorism for a long time, and foreign fighters, I think it'll increasingly be this way, is they don't have to play by the rules of sovereignty, and we do. And so it seems to me that there's a third variable sort of out of there, and that's the private sector that hasn't really been discussed. And so my question is, I was thinking back, and I was thinking of ways that we can somehow gain footholds or gain entries or gain pressure on actors in a lot of these places which are failed or weak states. And the one thing that we do have in common is links to multinational corporations, things like that, that have very solid interest in it. And I was thinking about Max Boot and the Savage Wars of Peets. It was always, you know, companies go in and then we deploy force, you know, expeditionary to protect certain interests there. What if, I don't really know, I'd love to get your guys' opinion on, what if we did that sort of in a reverse fashion? Some of the studies that we looked up at West Point was, we would like to do a policy in Pakistan, but it becomes a form of extraction from us to them to perform on our behalf, as we fund it. Are there some strategies, or what are the problems with doing it in reverse, where multinational corporations maybe that reside within NATO or other coalition partners, we put pressure on them to leverage and reverse against those national leaders such that they lose resources based on how they're able to sustain or stabilize certain areas or work on issues of transnational groups? Just wanted your thoughts on that.
It seems like one of the problems right here is not, I mean, it'd be a great idea if you could do it. But the problem would be is that, look, everyone, you know, you've heard the discussion back in the 1990s about the state was going away. The state's not going away. The state just continued to be there. States adapt. And one of the things states have recognized is they are losing control over financial and commercial issues. You know, there was a time, if you go back to, 1956, the United States got Israel to stop in its tracks during the Suez Crisis. Because we had leverage over the French, the British, and the Israelis. We don't have that kind of leverage now. We're much more absolutely powerful than we were then, but in terms of our ability to control financial flows and so forth, it's just, you try to that, capital will find a way to go someplace else. And I think that's the real practical problem for this whole thing, is to do these sorts of issues, is the sort of multiple routes that capital can flow, where I don't think that would have the kind of impact you want. However, there's an interesting, we forget sometimes, sort of another private response to, say, piracy. Our Constitution says we can issue letters of mark and reprisal. So that's, you know, maybe what we're talking about here. You know, Blackwater at sea, I don't know, something like that to deal with that. That's different what you're talking about, though.
In the late 1980s, the G7 organized an effort to go after terrorist finance, I believe. And I think it's had considerable success. I don't know a lot about it, but essentially these countries threatened financial, maybe I shouldn't use the word threatened, but made it known that they would reveal unfavorable information about financial institutions in countries that were harboring foreign fighters or terrorists, that they would reveal information in that regard. And these financial institutions, of course, are very sensitive to that kind of information. And there has been a lot of cooperation in that front among major financial institutions around the world, and even in countries where you might not expect it, in terms of doing something about foreign fighter finance. And that sounds to me a little like what you're talking about. As far as trying to get multinational corporations more involved, I wonder if that wouldn't be almost akin to unilateral economic sanctions. somewhat, maybe almost completely ineffective unless you could get broad support for such an effort. And then you're not really talking about trying to lean on a multinational corporation to bear that burden on its own. But again, that's very difficult to do. The way a businessman might see it, there's money to be made, and they also have a lot of influence in their capitals as well. So,
let me add 2 points. One is, I think it's very difficult to coerce a private sector, especially a multinational corporation, to act on the basis of a specific policy formulated by a state. They respond to shareholders, not to voters. And the shareholders tend to be, you know, across borders. And they'll make the decisions a bit on the basis of profit, not on the basis of what we think is more palatable from a policy perspective, more developing our security, and so on and so forth. So I think it's just the mentality is different. You probably can coerce them through essentially sanctions, but that's a different story. Second aspect of private actors. I think when private actors are attacked, and I have in mind, for instance, oil or mining companies, oil companies in Africa or mining companies in Indonesia, for instance, that's where they react. The challenge of that is, I think, twofold. One is that you have the privatization, a further privatization of international relations, and we have limited control over what they do. They may start acting in ways to undermine our own policy and our own relationship with a specific state in question, whether it's Indonesia or Sudan or whoever. Second, they develop their own set of foreign fighters, essentially, that once their company doesn't need them, what happens to them? I don't know. Historically, there was always a problem with mercenaries. It was nice when there was a war going on. You know, you can channel them to specific battlefields. Once the war ends, you have a problem with bandits. That's what was a typical problem of the Ottoman Empire. The Ottoman Empire was very domestically stable when they had wars on their borders because they would employ bands, mercenaries from their territory and send them to the borders. Once that war was stabilized, it was no longer a war, they had a serious domestic instability because of these bands. So it may be, you know, if you encourage the privatization of security, the privatization of security provision for even private companies, you may have sort of serious consequences later on down the road. Not exactly your question, but along those lines.
No.
Yes. Yeah. Just to continue on with the theme of the privatization of violence, Ian early on mentioned super empowered individuals. At least as far as I know. And just whether or not the state is in retreat, it just strikes me that you are dealing a lot with the privatization of violence through weapons proliferation. And you know, I've been thinking about other types of organizations. We don't hold Italy directly responsible for the actions of the mafia out of Sicily. We don't hold the Colombian government responsible in the same way for the actions of cartels that we hold a lot of in Middle East and North African states responsible for actions of foreign fighters. So I'm just wondering, from a legal standpoint, which I don't know much about, what is the sovereign responsibility of states for private actors operating out of their borders? Is it a form of collective punishment to go after those states in the sort of ways we've discussed for these entities?
I think that the technical legal answer would be that the Security Council can identify threats to the peace and can take action to deal with it. I think that's the answer. Of course, you have to get all five permanent members to go along with that in any given case.
Well, a broader answer to your specific question. I think power matters. The example I had in mind, it was not exactly a mafia, but say the Red Brigades in Italy. They're using Semtex produced in the Czech Republic, or Czechoslovakia then. They were trained by and financed to a certain degree by secret, you know, the KGB essentially. Well, you know, the power situation was such that we were not going to go bomb Czechoslovakia and bomb some camp in the USSR. It was just too dangerous, right? So, you know, it wasn't because we respected state sovereignty. It's just we respected the situation on the ground, the balance of power, and we acted prudentially because we read the situation in a way. That changes when the power differential is different, right? If this is some godforsaken, godforgotten country that has no nuclear missiles, that it is not a superpower, we think differently. We would, you know, if this was country X in the middle of nowhere that supported the Red Brigades, the country X would be gone. Libya in the 80s, right? How many times did we bomb and how many Libyan MiGs did we shoot down? Because they bombed a disco in Berlin or in Germany, and so on and so forth. So again, the power differential, I think, has something to say about the question you asked.
Listening to this whole discussion put me in mind of a story that I think illustrates what, at least to me, is the logical conclusion. In 1808, the Duke of Wellington diverted an army headed for the Caribbean to Portugal because Napoleon had invaded Spain. And when he landed, he declared that he was intervening in defense of the principle of non-intervention, which provoked from the French foreign minister, Talleyrand, this expression, that the word non-intervention is an English word with metaphysical connotations, but in practice cannot be distinguished from intervention. Now, it seems to me that when we're dealing with foreign fighters and sovereignty, every action that is going to violate another sovereignty is going to be taken in the defense of the principle of sovereignty, either that of the country that's being hit or that of the country that has failed to do one thing or another. So unless we wish to belong to the very large legal school of reductio ad absurdum, we end up with principle always following prudence. Am I correct?
I think one of the points there, of course, is this idea that, after all, presumably a violation of sovereignty is in response to another violation of sovereignty. I mean, in the case of, again, Spain, Spanish Florida in 1819 or any other thing. It, you know, it's a principle of, I like the old term, the law of nations, going all the way back to Grotius and Pufendorf and Patel and all those people like that, that, you know, self-defense was certainly a legitimate response. And so I think that's great. You said it much more elegantly than I could have, but I mean, the idea basically that most of what we think of as being violations of sovereignty are responses to prior violations of sovereignty.
I agree. I mean, perhaps most wars in history have been justified as maintenance of sovereignty. I agree.
You're the president, so I agree too. But yeah, exactly. But you know, I think that. But that's the challenge of foreign fighters, because I guess the question is whether we consider foreign fighters a violation of sovereignty perpetuated by the country of origin of those foreign fighters, and the answer is yes, no, maybe. It depends maybe on the role of that state, maybe on the size of foreign fighters, and so on and so forth. So I think the debate, and it's, to me, it's still unclear what's the answer to that question. Is 10 Uyghurs fighting against a U.S. army, is that a violation of our security by China? Is 10, you know, hundreds of Saudis in Iraq and attacked by Saudi Arabia or a violation of our security interests from the country of origin? I don't know what the answer is to that.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, we've reached the end of our time here. Please join me in thanking the panel.